testimony, you ought to be able to say, I've been truly blessed. Amen. I've got a testimony. Amen. You don't get a testimony without going through a test. And knowing that God is the one that brought you through. Praise God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. For him continuing to just be so good. So kind. That he would look beyond our faults and simply see our needs. For those of you that have your Bible, we invite you to turn with us on this first Sunday here in July, the first day of July. We ask that you would turn to the Gospel according to Mark, the 10th chapter. The Gospel according to Mark, the 10th chapter. Now, curriculum today will start at verse number 46. We ask those of you who are able that you would please stand for the reading of God's holy and righteous word. Mark chapter 10, starting at verse number 46. We'll start reading from the King James Version. There you'll find these words written. And it says, and they came to Jericho. And as he went out of Jericho with his disciples and a great number of people, blind Bartimaeus, the son of Timaeus, sat by the highway side begging. And when he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to cry out and say, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And many charged him that he should hold his peace, but he cried the more a great deal, thou son of David, have mercy on me. And Jesus stood still and commanded him to be called. And they called the blind man, saying unto him, be of good comfort, rise, he calleth thee. And he, casting away his garments, rose and came to Jesus. And Jesus answered and said unto him, what wilt thou that I should do unto thee? The blind man said unto him, Lord, that I might receive my sight. And Jesus said to him, go thy way. Thy faith had made thee whole. Immediately he received his sight and followed Jesus in the way. God's word for God's people. It is blessed and may that a blessing to us all. Eternal God, our Father, again, Lord, we do thank you. Thank you, God, for just being able to wake up this morning and see the dawning of a new day. We thank you, Lord, that when we woke up this morning, we were still clothed in our right mind. We still had strength in our bodies. We still had the articulation of our speech. And we thank you, Lord, that you allowed us to come here to your house of prayer just one more time. And so, Father God, we know that you're already in this place. We know that you're already moving amongst your people. And so, Father God, in the name of Jesus, we pray now that you would speak to us, Father God, and speak to us in such a way, Lord, that we know that we have heard from you. Then as always, Father God, your manservant, I pray now that you would hide me behind the cross, that only you might be seen. I pray, Lord, that you would speak to my mind and speak through these bits of clay, that I might give your words, you have given it unto me. And then as always, Father God, I ask for preaching power, the kind of power that makes preaching easy. Lord, I ask all these things in your Son, Jesus Christ, and our Lord and Savior, and his holy and his precious name. Let the church say, amen. Amen. In recognition of this upcoming 4th of July holiday, church, I want to speak a word today that says, it's time for us to be free. All right. It's time for us to be free. You see, all over this country we call America, we're about to celebrate what has been tagged as Independence Day. That's right, the Day of Freedom. You see, because on July 4th, 1776, America declared, we're free at last, we're free at last. Thank God Almighty, we're free at last. You see, but church, the truth of the matter is, when America declared her freedom, not everybody in America was really free. You see, some of us in here can testify and know that there was a group of people in this country that were being deprived of that freedom. There were some people on some plantation being oppressed by the very country that was declaring it was free. Our ancestors at that time was being held down and held up by the institution of slavery. Now, I don't want to ruin anybody's holiday celebration. Now, I want you to get your fireworks and have your cookout, but the truth of the matter is, on the 4th of July, 1776, not everybody in America was celebrating freedom. See, because again, our ancestors, black folks, they didn't know what freedom looked like. They had never even heard or seen or experienced freedom. You see, because slavery was the only thing that many of them had ever known. And our ancestors, they were taught to believe that things were the way they were because God wanted them that way. They even preached it from the pulpit that since God wanted it that way, it was nothing that could be done or would be done to better their situation. That's why, church, I tell people all the time, don't ever let somebody else try to tell you what God doesn't want for you. You see, because the truth of the matter is the devil is a liar. Because God did not want our ancestors to be slaves.
That's right.
Because we are the king's kids. No matter what they try to tell you, no matter what kind of picture they want to put up, we are the king's kids. And the truth of the matter is, God wants the best for his children, and God wants us to be free. And that's why he said in his word, whom the Son is free indeed. You see, church, but today, us, the king's kids, the problem with so many of us is that we have traded in the bondage of slavery for the bondage of sin.
All right.
Many of us are right back in the same stuff that God has gotten us out of. Because if we can be honest in here this morning, some of us are so deep in sin and have gotten so used to sin that we don't even think that our sinning is that bad. There's some people that's been sinning for so long that they have convinced themselves that sinning is the norm. But I come to tell you that sin is that bad. Because the wages of sin is still death. Which means that we can go on playing with sin if we want to. But somebody here knows that sin is just like trouble. It's easy to get into, but it can be hard to get out of. Somebody can testify that sin is just like glue because once you get it in your hands, it'll stick right to you. Somebody else can testify that sin is just like quicksand. The longer you stay in it, the deeper you're going to fall.
All right.
Somebody here can testify that sin is just like bad breath. You can't see it, but you know it. Somebody's got it. That's why you got to stay away from sin. Don't play with sin. I hope somebody hears me today because there are some of us in here that can testify that sin will cause you to do some things that you didn't plan on doing. It'll cause you to go some places that you didn't plan on going. It'll make you stay longer than you plan on staying. And it'll make you pay more than you planned on paying. But for anybody in here this morning that said, look, I'm tired of living under the bondage of sin. I'm tired of living like a slave to sin. Then the good news is you come to the right place this morning because God can do what you can't do. And God has come to set you free. And that's the good news of this text today. This man named old blind Bartimaeus, one that's not really talked about in the text. We don't know a whole lot about Bartimaeus other than he was blind and he was the son of a man named Timaeus. But what this Bible does teaches us in the context of this marvelous story is there are some things that we all need to do if we truly ever want to be free. And I'm not talking about being free in the sense of no constitution from the United States of America, but I'm talking about being free and free indeed.
Yes, yes.
You see, this story picks up in chapter 10 as Jesus was traveling through Judea on his way to Jerusalem, where the Son of Man had to suffer and die. And as he traveled along the way, the Bible said that he stopped in the city known as Jericho. And there is where we pick up our text this morning. There is where Bartimaeus teaches all of us what it is that we need to do if we truly want to be free. And so the first thing that Bartimaeus teaches us, if you want to be free, is we need to recognize our opportunity. Because somebody who knows that opportunities come and opportunities go. And oftentimes, they come no more. Because the text church, it does not say how long that Jesus had been in Jericho, but my sanctified imagination leads me to believe that somehow, some way, that while Jesus was in Jericho, that word had gotten out to the Jericho word to Bartimaeus that the man named Jesus from Nazareth, he was in town. And something tells me that when Bartimaeus heard that the same man that had made the lame man walk and the deaf dumb man talk, the same man that had healed the sick, the same man that had given sight to the blind, when Bartimaeus heard that he was now in town, something in his mind said, this may be my one and only opportunity to get to see Jesus.
Yes, yes.
Bartimaeus said, I may not have a chance to get to Jesus tomorrow, but I can get there today. Yes. You see, because we all know Jesus, he performed many miracles, church, but of all the miracles he performed, he gave sight to the blind more than he did anything else. And I can imagine old blind Bartimaeus sitting there beside that road saying to himself, this may be my only opportunity. This may be my day. This may be my time. So the Bible said that he began to cry out, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me. My friends, if we ever really want to truly be free, we got to do like Bartimaeus did. We got to recognize our opportunity and we got to call out to Jesus, because the word says, if you call him, he will answer. Yeah, I don't know who I'm talking to this morning, but something tells me that somebody came in here this morning. They came in here needing something from God. And all I can tell you is, you can act like I'm not talking to you. And act like you got it all together. But God knows the truth, and God is waiting to set you free. And all you got to do is just call out to God. You see, because some of us have been trying some stuff, and we've been trying it for a long time. And what God wants to know is, how long are you going to keep waiting? How long are you going to keep dealing with the same situation before you simply call out to Jesus, before you simply give God a try? You see, because whether you know it or not, today, church, it is your day. And today might be your last day. Today might be your last opportunity to just call out to Jesus. So that's why all I can tell you is, if you know you need to be free, you know you need something from God, or you need a touch from God, then now is your time to cry out to him and ask God to have mercy on you. The second thing that the text teaches us we need to do is we need to be willing to risk it all.
Yeah.
You got to be willing sometimes to take a risk. Because in order to understand what Bartimaeus really was doing here, church, you got to understand the Jewish custom of the day. There was often a rabbi or a teacher that would be walking along these desert roads, and then while they were walking, their followers would gather around them and listen intently to the teaching of their master. But one of the jobs of the followers were to make sure that everybody that encountered their master, that they showed him reverence and respect. And so here they are traveling along this Jericho road. And then in the distance, they hear a voice crying out, Jesus, thou son of David, have mercy on me.
Wow.
The Bible said that when they heard this, that the disciples went over to Bartimaeus and they told him, shut, be quiet. Can't you hear Jesus talking? The Bible said that the more they tried to shh him, the more Bartimaeus cried out. And the Bartimaeus just said to himself, yes, I'm going to cry out to Jesus. I might be risking my safety, my freedom, my life, or my reputation, but I'm going to keep on crying until I get what I need.
Right.
You see, because although he could not see, he could recognize that this may be his one and only opportunity to get what he needed from Jesus. Bartimaeus said, Jesus might not ever come this way again. So now, while I have a chance, I'm willing to risk it all for Jesus Christ. And so Bonson May said, I'm going to cry out to Jesus, and I'm going to cry until I can't cry no more. And he just cried with all that he had.
Yes.
You see, because sometimes, church, in order to get a touch,
yes,
you got to be threatened. Sometimes you got to go through something. Sometimes when you know you need something from God, the best thing you can do is ignore what other people got to say.
That's right.
Sometimes you got to hear what they say and don't let their problem become your problem. You got to be willing to put your neck on the line, and you got to be willing to risk it all for Jesus Christ. Because I'm here to tell you, not everybody sitting on your road wants you to see Jesus. Come on, there's some people that you think are down with you, and the truth of the matter is they want you to be ragged in a roach. They want you to be doing bad, just as bad as they are. They don't want you to be blessed. And so what they'll tell you to do is, shut up, it don't take all of that. We in church, you need to act sanctified and dignified. And that's all right if you don't need something from Jesus.
That's right.
But if you know you need a touch, if you know you need God to step into your situation, you can't afford to keep your mouth shut. You got to pray out, despite what other folks got to say. Because look at it in the text. These same people that would tell blind Bartimaeus to shut up, all of them could see. He wasn't asking Jesus to give them their sight, because they already had what he was asking for. And that's what happens sometimes. You'll be sitting around some folks who think they don't need nothing from Jesus, who think they already got everything that they need. And so since they don't need nothing from God, they assume that you don't need nothing either. And so they'll tell you to sit down and shut up. And that's when you got to say, you don't know what I've been going through. Sometimes you got to say to folks, you don't know what I've been going. You don't know what it took for me to get here today. You don't know how bad I need the Lord to touch me. I understand if you don't need nothing from God. If you don't need nothing, you sit down and you be quiet. But I need something from Jesus. Jesus, thou Son of David, have mercy on me. Again, sometimes you got to let your friends know, your closest so-called friend, look, I'm willing to risk you not liking me. I'm willing to risk you not wanting to sit by me next Sunday. I'm willing to risk you not inviting me to your 4th of July cookout. That's all right. But I'm not willing to risk my gentle Savior passing me by. Pass me not, oh gentle Savior. Sometimes you got to be honest. I don't know if I can make it to next Sunday.
That's right.
With what I'm going through. I got to get Jesus' attention right now. And that means that you ain't going to want to sit by me next week, and I hope you enjoy what you said.
Yeah.
But I'm going to call out to Jesus.
All right.
Next, Bartimaeus teaches us that in order to be free, we need to cast some things to the side. But again, if you let your sanctified imagination work, what you'll see is there's a picture of this old blind man sitting beside the road, begging for. You get the picture of Bartimaeus with this old raggedy clothes. Probably not dressed to impress. The text said that he heard that Jesus was in town. The Bible said they couldn't see, but it could hear. The Bible said they heard that Jesus of Nazareth was passing by. So in the midst of hearing that, the Bible said that he called out. What I like about this story is the Bible said that Jesus heard his cry.
Yes, yes.
Again, it tells you what kind of good God it is that we serve, that in the midst of everything that's going on around him, Jesus still hears your cry.
Yes. Amen.
Jesus knows the voice of his sheep. But again, church, what I want you to notice in the text is that when Jesus called him, the Bible said that immediately he cast away his dog. I believe that Bartimaeus cast away his garments because he realized that you can't be the same with Jesus as you were before Jesus. You see, because once you hook up with Jesus, you got to change some stuff and you got to get rid of some stuff. Because the word says you got to be willing to lay aside every that does so easily beset us. You see, because some of us have been trying to come to Jesus. We've been trying to come for a long time. But the problem is, we've been carrying a heavy load. And I've come to let you know that, yes, Jesus is a heavy load bearer. But he's also a heavy load sharer. That's why he said, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I shall give you rest. So the question you got to ask yourself is, how tired am I?
All right.
Do I need some rest? Do I need a break from this heavy load and all these weight? Because some of us, we look like we got it all together, but there's some people in here this morning carrying the weight of a jealous heart. Carrying the weight of a lying tongue, the weight of bad finances, the weight of a bad marriage, the weight of a bad doctor's report. And what Jesus is saying is, I can help you with that.
All right.
Again, I don't know what your weight is, but what I can tell you is, it's time to lay it down. It's time to cast it aside. And it's time to come to Jesus. Because Jesus said, whosoever will, just let him come. But if you want to come to Jesus, you can't bring some of that stuff with you.
Yeah.
There's some stuff you got to be willing to get rid of.
Yeah,
not asking you to get rid of. I know Jesus is going to work on you when you get there, but there's some stuff you got to get rid of before you ever get there.
Yes.
And so the text, as it takes the final turn towards the end, here Bartimaeus teaches us the last thing you really truly need if you want to be free. We need to have an attitude of gratitude. You got to respond the right way to what Jesus has done for you. And as the story comes to a close, we see that blind Bartimaeus is now standing in the presence of the Lord.
Yes.
And Jesus said to him, what wilt thou that I should do? And that's just a nice way of Jesus asking, look here, man, how can I hook you up?
Yeah.
Anybody here know anything? Nothing like going to somebody and saying, look here, I can hook you up. I got the hook up. Jesus said to Bartimaeus, look, I heard your cries. I know that you got the faith. See, Jesus knew that he had the faith simply by how he called his name.
That's right.
He said, he referred to him as my son of David.
That's right. Yeah.
That was, in other words, telling him, I know who you are.
Yes, yes.
And I know who sent you. And because of what I know about you, I came to you asking that you might bless me. So Jesus said to him, ask of me what you will, and I will give it unto you. What I like about Bartimaeus' church is Bartimaeus can try to get all cute and sanctified. You know, some of us, when we pray and ask God for something, we know what we need, but we want to get all cute. Lord, just bless me. Lord, just take care of me. Lord, just let your hand of love be upon me and my family.
Uh-huh.
Bartimaeus said, now that's your bread. Uh-huh. Bartimaeus said, Lord, right now, in the name of Jesus, help me to see. He said, I know that you're Lord, Lord, and King of Kings, but can you restore my sight?
Uh-huh.
I know that you're the one that has all power in your hands, and you can even move mountains, but right now, the only thing I want is my sight. He said, Lord, I know you're the author and the finisher of my faith, and that every good and perfect gift comes from you, but right now, in the name of Jesus, can you help me to see? Sometimes you got to get specific with God. Sometimes you got to let down the veil and step into the presence of God and get real specific about what you need from God.
Yeah.
And you can't be ashamed for other folks to hear it. Sometimes it's good to be in the secrecy of your prayer life. Well, my Bible said that when he asked God for something specific, God gave it to him. Because the text said immediately his sight was restored. Again, church, what I want you to notice now is that after Bartimaeus had been blessed, Bartimaeus didn't go on about his own business.
Uh-huh.
He didn't go enjoy his blessings.
All right.
No, my Bible said that immediately he followed Jesus along the way. And the reason that Bartimaeus followed Jesus was he knew where his blessings came from.
That's right.
And he knew that he wanted to follow Jesus as a way of having an attitude of gratitude, because that was his way of saying, thank you, Lord, for what you've done for me. Sometimes you got to get personal with God. Lord, I thank you for blessing my neighbors. I thank you for blessing the folk that's sitting on my road. But Lord, I also want to thank you for everything you've done for me.
Yes, yes.
Because I could not have done it on my own. That's why every now and then you got to ask yourself the question, how good has God been to me? What are the things that God has brought me through? How many doors has God opened that no man can shut in my life? How many times has God healed my body? How many times has God answered my prayers? And then you give God the kind of praise that shows how good he's been to you. God has been good to you, then that's all right. You hold your praise for yourself. But if you know that God has been better to you than you've been to yourself, and you can say that can't nobody do me like Jesus, can't nobody do me like the Lord, then you ought to always give God praise. The kind of praise that you got to give God is the kind of praise that said, for God I live and for God I die. The kind of praise that said, here I am, Lord, send me. The kind of praise that says, I'll bless him in the morning, I'll bless him in the evening, I'll bless him in my going out, I'll bless him in my coming in, I'll bless him when I'm up, I'll bless him when I'm down, because I'll bless the Lord at all times. I'm going to keep his praise continually in my mouth. Now that offends some folks, that I don't mind offending you for Jesus. But I'm going to give God some praise.
Yes.
Because God has been good to me. You don't know how many prayers that God has answered in my life.
Yes.
You don't know where God has brought me from.
Yes.
Some of us in here can testify, look, I don't look like what I've been through.
All right.
Like, if you can watch on the DVD screen of your life, and let my life show up, some of y'all can testify. I'm talking to some of y'all about where you grew up and how you grew up. And if you know that God has been good to you, you know where you're living now compared to where you grew up.
Yes.
You know what you're driving now compared to what mom and daddy used to drive. Come on now. Some of y'all know that's a mighty good God it is that he sent.
Yes.
That he would do all these things for somebody like me. Because I ain't always been that good.
Yes, sir.
I ain't always had it all together. God could have left me where he found me.
Yes.
He could have left some of those folk that were running the street with me. But instead, he chose. That's the goodness of God, church, that he loved us. Wow, we were still yet sinners. God looked beyond our many, many faults, and he simply saw our needs. And the number one need that God saw that we needed was a Savior. That's why he sent his son down 40 and two generations. That's why he sent his son to that old rugged cross. That's why he sent his son down into a horrible grave. That's why he saved that Friday and all that Saturday. And that's why he got to pray that Sunday morning with all powers in his hands. Because God knew that we could not work ourselves back to him. We needed a Savior that would open the door. Tear the veil so that we might have access to God. It's time, church, for us to truly be free. I'm not talking about being free because the Declaration of Independence or the preamble. I'm talking about being free and free indeed. And the only way you can be free and free indeed is you know that Jesus is coming to your heart and forgive you of all of your sins. Come on, let's go.